internet and comic book fans alike! It's me, Troy to the Max Extreme here!
Oh my word! It ghost hunter Dave.
And together we form Imperius Rex. We are cram stuffing our summer full of Invincible.
Robert Kirkman, Ryan Ottley, Cory Walker.
Mm-hmm. Coming at you with 144 issues of Invincible. This block that we're getting into right now.
Yes.
Is trades 1 through 9 or compendium 1.
This giant phone book of a read.
Mm-hmm.
Invincible compendium 1.
Plus a few other little fun things that we'll throw in there along the way.
Were they though? Were they fun?
Yes.
Yeah, I had a great time. Just a test. Image Comics,
yes.
Of the Skybound imprint, mm-hmm. Robert Kirkman's own bread and butter.
That's right.
So this pubbed in 2003
mm-hmm.
until now, basically.
Yeah,
it just wrapped up, 2018.
Yep.
So however many years that is.
Very nice.
And the book, Invincible, focuses on Mark Grayson, teenage son of Omni-Man,
mm-hmm.
who's essentially the Superman stand-in for
mm-hmm.
this universe.
Mm-hmm.
And protector of the world.
That's right.
That's right.
A guardian of the globe, if you will.
I will.
Oh, great.
Himself and others, guardians of the globe.
Yes.
Essentially the Justice League.
Mm-hmm.
And Omni-Man, he's not from Earth.
He is not.
He is from the Viltrum, planet Viltrum,
mm-hmm.
which is this just wonderful alien race that wants to spread wisdom and protection across the universe. Right, Troy? Right. Yep. So,
yeah.
he's Earth's protector. He's
yep.
the champion.
Mm-hmm.
And Mark, his son, is mm-hmm. just waiting. Just counting down
yep.
the days until he...
Chomping at the bit.
Yeah.
To get a little piece of what his dad has. Them superpowers,
that's
babe.
Right. Give me them superpowers. Give him.
He just needs them.
Give him here. That's right. So he wants to be a hero like his father. And
mm-hmm.
why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you want to fly... punch moons.
Right.
Do whatever you want.
I don't think there's one bit of moon punching in this, but he could do it.
They go to a moon.
That's very true. Well, spoilers.
Sure, they punch around a bit on it. Sorry. Getting ahead of ourselves. So, Kirkman, as he's wont to do, much like he does on Walking Dead,
mm-hmm.
is a sole writer
mm-hmm.
of this entire series.
Yep.
And he also plays the long game.
He does. He deconstructs the genre.
Yes.
As he did with The Walking Dead, he turns it more into like a people story, not just a zombie story. And this
right.
is taking the superhero tropes
mm-hmm.
and maybe turning some on their head, playing around with the ideas of some of the things that happen in superhero stories.
That's right.
And he fills that out throughout the rest of the series.
Along on his journey, Cory Walker
mm-hmm.
draws the first 7 issues,
mm-hmm.
I believe. Does a great job.
Mm-hmm.
And he pops back in later. After he leaves the book, Ryan Ottley
mm-hmm.
comes on and really makes Invincible his own.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure.
They go hand in hand.
Mm-hmm.
Ottley and Invincible.
That's right.
So as we said, this tells a long story, but also does a lot of really good small character arcs,
yeah.
too, where you don't ever know what's going to happen. anything in this will catch you off guard. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't tell you, like, oh, this arc is good or this arc is good, because it's all good.
Right.
And stuff is happening everywhere.
Right.
It's not like it's 30 issues of build-up to one big event.
Right.
It's always stuff going on.
Yeah.
Which makes it kind of hard to do, like, a big review of it, because... I mean, we're just going to tell you about a lot of stuff and what we think of it. There's big moments, but there's so many little moments along the way that are just as good, if not better.
Yeah. I think even in, like, some of the back matter and, like, the layouts and stuff that they show at the end, like, little artist stuff, he even makes jokes that he's like, well, I wanted to do this, but I already had 47 ongoing plot lines going on in this book, so I had to cut that one. So he's fully aware of what he's going after.
Absolutely. But that being said, this book is a breeze to read, too. It's not overpowering. There's so much going on, but it flows so well. And then even with all the crazy superheroics that's going on, I think one of the book's biggest pluses are, like, the quiet character moments.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Because when the characters... and those usually get the most page counts, too. Like, just a story... like, 3 pages dedicated to this one moment that's going to pay off in his character like, later down the line.
Yeah.
And I really enjoy that stuff.
Yeah.
And it works really... because it's natural. It's not melodramatic
most
of the time, especially in these first few trades.
Oh, yeah.
Like, these quiet character moments are really special, and, like, you can almost... not almost, but you can really... get behind these characters, because it's, like, something that you may have experienced in your life already.
Yeah, for being everyone in the book is a superhero, essentially, they're extremely relatable.
Right, right. Even more than, like, Spider-Man is, because he was supposed to be that kind of... maybe he was in the 60s, but now he is completely not relatable.
Oh, he's got his own tech company. Who knows what's going on?
Oh, whatever is going on with him right now.
But you really do, like, you follow their entire... growth in his characters. You start with Mark in high school and go on to him in college, and then he eventually leaves college and becomes, like, a full-fledged superhero, all this stuff. They leave Earth, they do all kinds of stuff.
Right.
We're getting ahead of ourselves. One of the book's greatest achievements is probably its cast of characters.
Yeah.
They're fantastic.
Yes.
Every one of them, this unique, original character that Kirkman has dreamed up, probably with the help of his artists. But they all feel like these long-running, established characters.
Right.
So Mark, when he first gets his powers, joins a superhero team called the Teen Team, which makes up of Robot, the team leader, a brilliant robot.
Right.
A long-running mystery, like, is someone in the suit? And what is it? What's Robot all about?
Right.
There's also Adam Eve, who he develops a relationship with a little bit later on.
Yep. One of my wife's favorite comic book characters of all time.
That's right. What's her power? Able to manipulate, like, the genetic...
like atomic... molecular composition of anything.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Quite a power.
Right.
Her boyfriend, Rexplode. Great.
An amazing name.
Just great. he's essentially Gambit.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Yeah. And Duplicate, who is, like, multiple man. Female multiple man.
Right.
And... these names are great. She eventually she has a brother named Multipaul.
It's so good. When that was dropped, I was like, perfect. I closed the book, take my glasses off, and take a nap and just smile.
So Mark gets his powers, joins his team. They're like the Teen Titans, essentially, on their way up to possibly join
Justice
the ranks
League
of the
type stuff.
The Guardians of the Globe. And I love when Mark first gets his powers. Like, he's waiting and waiting. But he gets them in the first issue. So you're not waiting forever.
Right.
It just seems like it's been a while. And he works in a fast food restaurant. And he goes to take out the garbage. And he just, like, gives it a toss. And, like, shoots it out into the atmosphere. Like, into space.
Right. Yeah.
And he's like, oh, great. They're here.
It's about time.
Yeah. 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 And then by the end of the first issue, he has his tailored costume. Because... all the superheroes go to this guy named Art, who runs, like, a tailoring place in a strip mall, but also does all these superhero costumes on the side.
In the back.
Yeah. And, yeah, he gets his costume, and then he goes out and fights crime, and he calls himself Invincible, because he is. So, early on in his career, he tackles a couple different missions. One of them is a teacher, former teacher, that's turning classmates into bombs, human bombs. They also tackle a slew of villains, like the Lizard League. What's the concrete guy?
Titan.
Titan?
Yeah.
Not very creative on the name there. Come on, Kirkman. The Mahler twins.
The Mahler twins come up.
One of them created a clone of himself, but they're constantly bickering on which one is a clone. They can't decide which one of them was the original.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes on forever throughout the entire series.
Right, yeah. And they got a guy named Isotope, mm-hmm. who, I don't know if he had to pull in a favor to get this, but the guy is a direct representation of what this James Sim guy who runs Isotope Comics in San Francisco looks like.
Really?
He's famous for, like, the tall hair and the mustache.
I was
going to
say, he has the hair.
He looks just like him.
Oh, boy.
So, like, if you're ever in San Francisco, check out Isotope Comics.
All right.
You'll see Isotope at Isotope Comics.
Sign one of them books.
Yeah, get him on it.
That's right. So, yeah, they have all kinds of adventures early on.
Mm-hmm.
And I love that Mark's mom is just so, like, fine with it. It's just, like, old news to her.
Right.
Like, she's making her dinner. They fly in, like, eat real quick. Like, hi, honey, how are you? Good. How was your day? Oh, great, we had to fight this guy. Oh, gotta go. And then they blast off. And I also love that when Mark and Adam Eve, who's his classmate at school, too, their, like, phone booth changing place is the school dumpster. Like, that's where they go to change into their costumes. They're like, to the dumpster! And they go, and, like, sometimes there's just classmates, like, making out over there.
So, early on in the series, they do a big twist.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is in the second trade?
Yeah.
Maybe? They...
Things aren't looking great for Mark for long.
No. So, Omni-Man, the big Superman of this in this Image universe, takes a bit of a turn.
Mm-hmm.
And not... he is not the holier-than-thou, I'm gonna enlighten this world and get it to its highest potential. It's more of along the lines of, I'm gonna kill all these people or enslave them and take them under my Viltrum Empire.
That's right. They're a conquering race.
Right.
And they believe in the survival of the fittest. Mm-hmm. And they will wipe out planets, mm-hmm. whatever it takes, to prolong their race.
Right. And I think that happens, like, in issue 7 or 8.
Yeah, because he single-handedly kills the entire Guardians of the Globe.
Right. In, like, 3 pages.
Yeah.
Which is great. Like, mm-hmm. and I think... here, like, the art, like, it was known as being, like, a kind of a gory thing.
Yeah.
But it was, like, pretty tame compared to what comes later in this.
Yeah. This is a book where you look at it and it's very fun and four color and, like, bouncy.
Yeah.
But the gore and violence in this is off the charts when it happens.
Right.
Like, it's not like that every issue, but
no.
When it happens, it's
shocking.
Playing for keeps. Yes.
And it ramps up as the series progresses. Because it almost, like, grows with the reader.
Mm-hmm.
If you started this in 2003 as, like, in your high school years or whatever, like, it'll eventually get more mature as the story progresses.
Like Harry Potter.
A bit. I don't like that reference.
I don't know. I've never read them.
But, so anyway, Omni-Man turns the world on his ear. I'm going to conquer you instead. He knocks out all the Guardians of the Globe.
And Invincible finds out,
yeah.
And he's like, what?
And so he confronts his dad, and his dad's like, either with me or you're against me. And Invincible's like, well, obviously I'm against you, because this sucks, but I don't want to fight my dad. And his dad just freaking starts attacking him.
Wipes the floor with him.
And, like, just creams Invincible.
And kills, like, cities worth of people in the process.
Right.
They're just destroying everything. If
End
people complain about Man of Steel, my lord,
they
just trash the world.
And so that has this big, huge, the biggest thing that happened in Invincible's life so far, obviously. And his namesake isn't quite so true. Omni-Man cleans his clock easily. And then, right as he has him dead to rights, he, like, starts welling up, and he's like, Dad, please don't do this. His dad turns around, flies into space, and you don't see him for a while.
Yeah. So they don't know what's up, but Invincible is nursed back to health, because
mm-hmm.
there was a secret government operation that was working with Omni-Man,
mm-hmm.
Led by Cecil Stedman.
Mm-hmm.
Always located in the Pentagon,
parking in the rear.
Yeah. And he basically says, I've been working with your dad. We had no idea he was this, like, secret op, or this horrible,
tyrant.
Like, covert mm-hmm. Viltrumite agent.
Yeah.
We've just been, like, directing him to national emergencies, and he's been saving the world all the time. So would you like to do this, Mark?
Mm-hmm.
And Mark's like, yeah. Yeah, pretty much. So Mark starts working for the government. He gets his earpiece, and the government takes care of him and his mother, and in exchange for Mark just doing what he was already going to do, be a superhero.
And there are still secret identities in this, too, because even though Omni-Man, like, is on camera turning against the whole world, they never know it's, like, Nolan Grayson.
Right, and famous author.
Famous author. So, like,
now dead in a car crash.
Right. And so, like, the government, like, fakes his death in a car crash and then makes all of his books number one bestsellers so it can show, like, in a realistic sense, how now Debbie is now well off.
Yeah.
So they think about all that kind of
stuff.
That's
right. That's what a lot of this book is. It's like, well, how would that happen? Mm-hmm. And he's like, yeah, that would be an interesting thing to explore. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of questions that aren't normally answered in superhero comics. So now Mark has kind of moved up. The Guardians of the Globe are gone. They reform it. They have Robot lead the team. And they pull in the one remaining member, who, the Immortal, who survived Omni-Man's attack because he is immortal. He's been alive for centuries. He was Abraham Lincoln at one point, among many other famous historical figures.
Right.
And then they kind of band together with a new group of superpowered individuals.
Some coming from the teen team, and then they have open tryouts for...
Yep, so we get people like Monster Girl, who is a young woman cursed by a gypsy to transform into a hulking monster. But every time she does it, she gets younger until, like, she will eventually become a baby.
Right.
And she's, like, an adolescent. Or, no, like, what do you say, preteens right now?
Right.
So she's... bitter on that.
Right.
She's quite. Essentially...
Because she's like 40 years old, but she looks no older than like 12 or 13.
And that's kind of the status quo for a while. Mark is just kind of doing his day-to-day superheroics, not knowing what's going to become of his father or any of that. His mother is going through like horrible depression.
Right.
Because she loved her husband.
Right.
And not only did he say this was all like a lie. He said, like, he never cared for his wife. Right.
She was
just
a pet more than anything. Yeah. So she's going through all that, and he's trying to balance, like, superheroic, school, all this kind of stuff, having a girlfriend.
Yeah. He gets a girlfriend, Amber Bennett.
Yeah.
Is that her name?
Yeah.
Who's beautiful blonde chick that likes him a lot. He eventually tells her that he's invincible, and it's fun for about 2 seconds until she realizes, like, he's always off-world, his life's always in danger.
Right.
And they stick it out for a while before eventually deciding, like, it's not gonna work.
Right.
And they handle it like adults, too. Yeah. They're like, hey, you know, it's just not, it's not fair for me to put you through this.
Right. That was the one thing where I thought it was like, you handle this surprisingly like adults. I think this would have gone off in real life a lot worse.
Yeah.
Like, you suck, you're never here. I told you, bitch, I will never come to be here.
I'm telling the press. And he goes off to college, too. Mm-hmm. So the book follows his high school graduation. He goes into college.
Mm-hmm.
He rooms with his friend, his lifelong friend, William, who's just an asshole. I hate William.
He really sucks.
Oh, he's the worst character in this. Just a punk.
Yeah.
But I do like when he's in college, he's constantly like, what am I doing here?
Yeah.
Like, I get it. Like, it's important, but not really for me.
No.
You know,
I'm out there already doing pretty good stuff for the world. Why do I have to learn? Like, get this.
And I'm getting paid by the government more than I would ever earn in a college level job.
Why do I have to get a bachelor's in business? Yeah. Like, what am I doing here or whatever?
So that's like a reoccurring thing. Like, I gotta save the world and then go home and study. So while he's in college, there's this reoccurring threat of these robotic zombies called the Reanimen, and we find out they're being created by this brilliant, creepy student named D.A. Sinclair, who's very much a Herbert West Reanimator character Reanimator.
Right.
So those are kind of his first reoccurring villains that he runs into.
Right. And you never get, like, what's... Because they show up, I think, like, in a first of the early trades, and you never get any explanation on them. And then it finally pays off, like, near this chunk of a run that we read, that, like, oh, there's finally a big payoff to that, and that's surprising, because now, as of this trade 9, Invincible still doesn't know what's up.
And eventually the government, he beats up Sinclair,
mm-hmm.
and then the government, Cecil Stedman, mm-hmm. takes him under his wing, and he's like, will you covertly build these soldiers for the government?
Right.
And that's something that's going to pay off later on, because this guy is a monster. And Cecil Stedman, who is Invincible's, like, go-to guy,
right.
is like, oh, yeah, why don't you work for us?
Yeah.
yeah, instead of, like, going to prison or getting the chair, like, oh, just be on the payroll.
Right. Why don't you use your brilliance for the U.S. government?
Yeah, yep. Mark's not going to like that. we also get introduced to Invincible's, probably his greatest villain.
Mm-hmm.
Troy Potter.
Me. his greatest villain, Angstrom Levy.
Yeah, great villain.
It was great. And they actually set this up on this reread. I didn't realize like how big of a setup that he kind of had.
Mm-hmm.
He is like an interdimensional type of villain where he can like kind of zip zap across like other dimensions and find other versions of himself. But there's only one version of himself that could do that.
Mm-hmm.
And so he wanted and able to do that better and like not just have to like blindly jumping to dimensions.
Yeah, because he would go to dimension B, but he wouldn't know where he's appearing.
Right.
So he wants to get all of the brains, basically mm-hmm. all of the intelligence of every version of himself so he can zip around and know exactly where he's going to pop up.
And so that's like an ongoing thread for a few issues. Him and he helps the, enlist the Mahler twins to help him in that.
Yeah. And, they and he wasn't this... ever planning on being evil.
Either. No.
He was going to use it for the greater good.
Yeah. Yeah. They build these like huge machines.
Big machine. Into this giant battery
right,
that's going to power
it. Filter everybody's knowledge into his own brain so he can just zip zop across everywhere. And so while that is happening, like, they're monitoring the Mahler twins, the government is, and, like, I don't know what's going on with them. They keep going in and out here with, like, PlayStations or whatever, trying to build this thing. And, like,
piecing it together.
They send Invincible there. He kind of screws up what he has going on, but at the same time, Angstrom is, like, he's pulling the plug on himself, too.
Yeah.
And so, but he blames Invincible for it.
As he gets his mind fried, essentially, and he turns into this giant, like, brainiac freak.
right.
Where his
like,
brain...
kind of like the leader or whatever.
Yeah, is, like, trailing down his body.
Yeah.
Great character design.
Really, yeah, awesome character design. And so, like, now he has, like, a ton of knowledge from whatever other versions of himself are in him, and he just is bitter towards Invincible.
And this can create portals to other dimensions. Like that.
Right.
Snap of the fingers.
And, like, this is where I mean, it's kind of far into the first, like, 9 trades that we read.
30s, maybe?
But, when like, I...
pops up, 34?
Even though I liked the book up until then, I thought this was the point where I'm like, I am really on board with this.
Yeah.
This is really good.
Because, like, the stakes went high with Omni-Man.
Yeah.
And that was a big, like, oh, this is something else.
Mm-hmm.
And then they kind of, like... they went back down a mm-hmm. little bit because he leaves Earth.
Right.
But then Angstrom is the first villain where it's like, oh, shit, this guy is dangerous.
Yeah.
Because he pops up and immediately, like, holds his mom hostage.
Right.
Like, breaks her arm and basically says, like, I could kill you and her and anyone at any time.
Right.
And I'm just going to, like, torture you until until I get my kicks out. And then I'm going to kill you.
Right.
And he just sends him to all these different universes.
Yeah. And which is really
like
fun.
Like on a gauntlet. Yeah, he has to go through.
Because as he's doing that, you kind of get to see like other worlds he's going to. Some aren't anything, but some are like the Walking Dead universe.
Walking Dead, yeah.
And there's actually one he gets zipped off to the Marvel universe.
616.
And they do a... Ooh, look out, y'all. They do a Marvel team-up with Spider-Man, and they actually printed this in Marvel, done by Cory Walker.
And Kirkman.
And Kirkman. And it's really fun. It's, like, one issue, even though it's, like, just between, like, two panels in the book. Like, there's a whole issue dedicated to it. And you can see, like, Spider-Man's webs coming off of him as he's coming back into the Image universe
and
stuff.
Yeah, they fit it in really well.
Yeah, it's really fun.
And then eventually, Invincible gets the upper hand, pulls Angstrom Levy into this desolate desert universe.
Right.
And beats him to death.
yeah.
Just... hard against him into the floor.
Yeah. And this is one of my favorite things, too, because, like, usually everybody in a superhero comic is, like, this indestructible being or whatever.
Yeah.
And so Invincible's just piss-pounding his face into the ground, and he's, like, realizes he's just killed him, and he's like, I thought you were gonna be stronger.
Yeah.
And, like, he just...
And now he's stuck there.
And now he has no way home, and you're like, holy shit!
Yeah.
Like, this is awesome!
And it's also, like, the first appearance of the Viltrumite anger.
Oh, yeah.
Because they, like, the Viltrumite race is a very warlike group, and they are prone to anger.
Right, yeah.
And outburst, and this is, like, Mark's first, like, losing control moment where he just obliterates him. And he's like, oh my god, what have I done?
Yeah. And so, he does get out of the situation, through, like, almost like a deus ex machina kind of a thing, where the Guardians of the Globe of the future of, like, I think it's the real future.
I think it's way in the future.
Well, I didn't know if it was, like, of his dimension or of, like, another one.
Yeah.
Of the, anyway, it doesn't matter. But it's, like, way in the future of...
Let me look.
The
I was right.
Of they come back and they find him and they said, like, we've been looking for you for, like, 15 years. And we finally did. And this is the point here where he's also with Amber. And the old Adam Eve says, like...
I've always
loved you. Before you go, I've always loved you.
Yeah.
Like, please tell me how you feel. Don't not ever say anything to me, because it'll break my heart. And so, like, I'm like, damn, this is fucking...
Good.
Doing these amazing personal moments that, like, this with huge scope. And I'm like, this is what this book does best.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And so he eventually does go back to his real world. He tells Eve how he feels. And Eve kind of is, like, taken back. Is like... You had to, like, be told to like me or something?
Yeah.
And he's like, well, no, but, yeah, and then it's kind of like a little...
That's about where we leave it in this.
Right, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
And so it's really well done.
Yep. And then amongst all that craziness, there's also some really good, like, story arc, typical superhero story arcs, one of which involves him going to monitor a manned mission to Mars.
Yeah.
Where they uncover a alien race there of Martians, I guess?
Yeah, they're Martians, yeah.
And they
obviously shapeshifters, like in every continuity.
Yeah, they're the Martian Manhunter characters.
Mm-hmm.
And they have a slave race of these squid-like, or starfish-like creatures called sequids. And the sequids can control any solid person and eventually, like, unite a hive mind and overtake anything.
Right.
But the Martians are shapeshifters, so they can't control them.
Right.
But if humans come on board,
mm-hmm.
all bets are off.
Right, yeah.
So, like, the Martians get the astronauts and they want to execute them so the sequids can't take control.
Right.
Invincible saves the people. They get off Mars, but one lone astronaut is left behind and he's under sequid control. So going forward, he commands this just insanely large race of starfish creatures.
Right, these little brainy starfish.
Yeah, that he's ready to go, like, attack the Earth with.
Yeah.
And this is some of the best Ryan Ottley art.
I think.
Like, the detail
top
on these
of his
things.
Game on this thing.
Oh, my God. It must have taken forever.
Right.
But he put this out on a monthly basis. Like, I don't think this ever was late.
I don't know.
This was, like, one of the most consistent books. But it's so good. And then in his place, one of the Martians came back to Earth and posed as the mission or the missing astronaut.
Right, yeah.
And he becomes an eventual, like, member of the team.
As the shapesmith.
Yeah. Yeah. Who's great.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, that adventure is fantastic. The look of the possessed astronaut is fantastic. I think he's a great looking character.
Yep. Backtracking a little bit.
We're going all over the place because this is just it's
but
hard
how
to
it
do
works.
Work.
Yeah. That's how it works. But, like, so you get to see Omni-Man again after he flies off.
Yeah, it's been 20, 30 issues or so.
And from, it's a cool kind of a thing where he goes to see his father, but he's greeted by his favorite comic book hero, Science Dog.
That's right. Because Mark's a comic book fan, and, like, the go-to comic book is Science Dog.
Right. And so, like, obviously he finds that very weird that Science Dog is coming to meet him at his front door. But it turns out it was, like, just a hologram of this other alien race that says, like, hey, you need to come here. We have news about your father.
Yeah. We have an emergency. We need your
help. Oh, yeah. He doesn't know it's his dad yet. But,
And also, we're mantis people.
Yes, we're mantis people. And so, like, he goes up to this planet where of the mantis people, finds out that the leader now of these mantis people is his dad.
That's where he flew off to when he left Earth.
And so these mantis people have super short lifespans. Of, like, 9 months or so.
Yeah.
And so, like, being a Viltrumite, he can live for thousands of years, and so the oldest member of this society becomes the leader.
Yeah,
which is him. No contest. Yeah. So now he's been the leader for probably several generations by now.
Yep.
And he's actually spawned another
family,
and
he's fallen in love with a mantis woman there.
And Mark has like a lot of thoughts about this. One, how does this work?
Mm-hmm.
Physically, how does physical love work with these mantis people?
Uh-huh.
And, like, now I have some sort of, like, stepbrother?
Yeah. And it, even more, like, Omni-Man has changed. His time on Earth has changed him. He's no longer this war-craving, utopian, perfect society person. He, like, he realizes, like, maybe humanity changed me for the better.
Uh-huh.
I can't go back to the Viltrum Empire.
Right.
I'm just gonna lay low here, but I need your help because they're coming for me.
Right.
So he basically enlists his son to help him.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, I don't know when they're coming, but they're going to be coming. We need to, like, train. You need to exercise.
Right.
And Mark realizes, like, I can do that. Like, I can increase my powers.
I just thought it was pretty strong already.
Yeah. Yep. So he's like, no, fly faster. And sure enough, the Viltrumites come for him.
Mm-hmm.
And it leads to, like, this, like, two-issue drag-out battle between three Viltrumite warriors that come to attack his father.
Mm-hmm.
And they just, oh my god. It is an exercise.
Quite an exercise. And very tense, too.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, as tough as he seems on Earth, like, the Viltrumites, hand over fist, have him beat.
Oh, yeah.
And he is, like, legit scared to save, like, his weird, like, stepbrother and this other mantis mother of this kid. Yeah. He's like a race against the clock to try to get to this hiding place. And
the
this
race
thing
is great.
Yeah.
Like, it is really intense. Like, he has to just fly, and he just keeps gaining on him. He's like, I've never gone this fast.
Really good tension there.
Yeah, it's excellent. And they have this drag-out battle where ultimately Omni-Man is captured and taken back to the Viltrumite Empire.
Mm-hmm.
Mark is beaten within an inch of his life and left there.
Mm-hmm.
And they say, like, they basically say, like, you're going to be the protector of Earth now.
Mm-hmm.
Either join us, or we're just going to come and lay waste to it.
Yeah.
And they leave him there.
Uh-huh.
And then he, after, like, a couple months, he's back to health. The mantis people have nursed him back to health. Now he's, like, the longest living person on the planet. He helps him rebuild, and then he heads back home with his baby brother.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, Mom, can you take care of this?
Look what I have.
Yeah.
And, like, she learns that, like, Nolan's still alive, and she has conflicting feelings, and all that kind of. It's really well done.
It is. And she develops a love for the baby.
Right.
It's not her baby, but it's part of him, and they name it Oliver.
After
her dad.
And he's
purple.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And he's not a mantis. He's taken the humanistic Viltrumite characteristics.
Right.
I love that all the Viltrumites have mustaches.
It's a great concept.
That's their defining characteristic, is they all have mustaches.
Yeah.
Oh, we should have talked about that earlier. Good lord.
I know.
So much happens.
So this
is the first third of the series.
Right. And we never even brought up, like, Alan the Alien and the Coalition of Planets or anything like that.
Yeah. So Alan the Alien is a guy that goes around to various planets and basically challenges their toughest protector to make sure that when the Viltrumites attack, they are protected.
Uh-huh.
And he's part of the Coalition of Planets, which is all of the planets kind of uniting, like United Nations, to hopefully fend off the Viltrumite Empire when they attack.
Yep.
And also the leader of the Coalition of Planets is Thaddeus. Is that his name?
I think so.
He's this wise, bearded guy, and at one point that he reveals himself to be a Viltrumite, he rips off his beard and the mustache stays, and they're like, oh, of course!
It's so clear now!
Yeah, he's a Viltrumite that defected, and he's like, oh, if Omni-Man and Mark have defected, then there may be hope for us.
Right.
So, that is essentially Invincible for the first third of it.
Right.
There's a couple little last moments that we want to talk about, I love the moment when the Lizard League attacks the Guardians of the Globe while most of them are on Mars fighting the Sequids.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
And the Lizard League, who's like the Serpent Society, just kills almost everybody and Rexplode almost single-handedly defeats them while, like, just getting the shit beat out of him.
Right.
He loses, like, an arm. Yeah. He gets shot in the head.
Yeah.
But he keeps on kicking.
Yeah.
I love that the uniforms are constantly tweaked throughout the series.
Right.
The tailor is right. always, like, kind of fixing them. Like,
right.
Invincible's knee pads change throughout.
Right.
And in the next arc, or the next compendium, his whole costume changes color.
Right.
For a while.
Man, I like the little knee pad thing, because it's just, like, something, an annoying little detail in the costume. Like, that sucks to draw. Let's just change it in the story.
Yeah.
And, like, if anyone asks, it's there.
Yep.
That's how I like
exactly.
that.
Yeah. I love that everybody wants Mark to take them flying.
Yeah, especially William.
Always wants him to go flying. He's like, not today, man. Not tonight. The reoccurring callback to the trash bag.
That's so fun.
That's good. Like that. Every once in a while, there'll just be a page where it just shows where the trash bag that he initially threw mm-hmm. when he got his powers. I think it lands in, like, London, mm-hmm. and people are, like, worshipping it as this yeah. random thing from the sky.
Yeah, yeah. It's just Burger Mart trash.
Yeah, yep.
What I really like early on in this book is that it does, like, a lot of, like, small mundane moments. And if you notice that, like, almost every single trade is a title of a sitcom.
Yeah.
And so, like, at the first trade, they really pay attention to that, and, like, he goes to Reginald Vell Johnson High School, which is the actor's name who played Carl Winslow on Family Matters.
Oh, boy.
And the principal is something Winslow, like, and looks like
he does. Reginald Vell Johnson. Just like him. Yep. I like the alien invaders that constantly come in.
Oh, yeah.
And in our universe, they age quicker than yeah. theirs, so, like, once they get to our universe, they immediately grow old and decrepit.
Right.
And then they come back again later, and they have, like, these wristbands that
right.
keep them from doing that.
Right.
And Invincible figures it out, smashes
right.
it, and they get old and decrepit again.
Yeah.
And I'm sure they pop up again.
Oh,
at
yeah,
some
they
point.
Pop up throughout the whole series.
Yeah, there's all kinds of these long-running jokes. Kind
and
of.
Like, they actually come back in a big way, like, near the third
mm-hmm.
chunk, and that we'll get to that.
The weird Rorschach character
oh,
that is investigating the
Damien
Guardians.
Darkblood or whatever
yeah.
his name
yeah.
is.
For a while, you only see him from behind, and he speaks like Rorschach
uh-huh.
down to the, like, the herm. And he's trying to figure out, like, who killed these superheroes, very much like how Rorschach was trying
right.
to investigate the death of the comedian.
Right.
And then you finally see him, and he's this weird baboon.
It's so good.
Is
and
he a character in the
Image
universe?
I have no idea.
And he keeps popping up. He's investigating. And then, like, by trade 2 or 3, he's like, I think I'm close. And then someone tells him, like, yeah, we already know. It was an Omni-Man.
Yeah.
It was all over the news.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh. And you never see him again. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, what was that?
And also that I love that it's that image because, like, I was just talking with, JT, one of my buddy from my other podcast or whatever.
You saw him in our Flex Metallo episode.
Yeah, as the big bully. But, I was telling him, like, they can do things in this that they can't do in, like, Marvel or
Absolutely.
DC.
Absolutely.
And so it's so refreshing just to have him take, like, this maybe, like, hyper-violent take just for a second.
Yeah.
Or, like, actually take just a moment to really extrapolate on, like, a slow moment or whatever.
Yeah.
It's really great.
As we kind of wind down here, let's talk real quick. This is a long-ass episode. These are, like, this is a big three-parter.
Mm-hmm.
This is a Godfather trilogy of Imperius Rex here.
Yeah.
But with good reason.
Right.
Because these... Don't put it on it.
I'm so sorry.
These are really good. And this is one of our favorite superhero books, so I want to give it the time it deserves.
Yeah.
It was eating me up inside that we spent, like, 15 minutes on it before. So there's also a couple other tie-ins. Oh, you have it. You have my science dog.
I do have the science dog. Ah!
There's the science dog tie-in, which isn't super essential, but it's just a fun little one-off story
uh-huh.
of science dog
uh-huh.
where... He is fighting his kind of main villain and gets abducted by aliens.
Mm-hmm.
He's needed to help them get back to their planet.
Mm-hmm.
It's a fun little time travel book.
Mm-hmm.
Cory Walker does the artwork, which
mm-hmm.
is great. It's 50 pages or so. Definitely worth your time. If
mm-hmm.
if you're reading Invincible, read this. It's fun.
Mm-hmm. Another one is the Adam Eve and Rexplode one-off trade.
Yep.
It's really good. It combines actually two series. One of just Adam Eve and the other one is Adam Eve and Rexplode.
Yeah.
But it's all one thing. It's not written by Kirkman.
No.
It's written by Benito Cereno and actually drawn from new comic artist Nate Belgrade.
I love it. I love the artwork in
it. The art is amazing and you actually get to see his progression because in the back it says like, this was his first book he ever did.
Really?
And so, at the beginning, you can see, like, how the art is, like, a little muddier.
Yeah.
And then as it goes on, you can see, like, how great it gets. And, like, I really like him as an artist.
That's so cool, because they kind of did that with Jason Howard.
Right.
When Kirkman had him write his Astonishing Wolfman
mm-hmm.
four-trade series. So it's mm-hmm. probably, like, 20 issues or so.
Mm-hmm.
And you totally saw that. He progressed over the course of the
yeah.
run.
Yeah.
I love that. And I love that Kirkman kind of seeks out these new talent, too, mm-hmm. to do it.
And his art style fits amazingly in
yeah.
this kind of universe that they're doing. And this is really good. It gives a lot of backstory on Adam Eve,
mm-hmm.
which you kind of get in like a one-shot little thing in this,
mm-hmm.
in the main series here. And a lot about Rexplode.
Yeah, you feel for Rex.
Yeah, I mean, he still comes off as a little bit of a dick, but
yeah.
like, you feel like, he had kind of a shitty life.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
So it's,
yeah.
It's really good. I would recommend this if you're a fan of Invincible wholeheartedly.
Yeah, it feels completely at home. Even written by a different writer,
mm-hmm.
it's very much in the tone of Robert Kirkman. So where are we leaving off on Compendium 1?
So Compendium 1, or Trade 9, leaves off with a Viltrumite woman, sans mustache.
Oh,
it's too bad.
Missed opportunity.
Her
there.
Name is Anissa, and she comes, and she's kind of like a big part in at least Mark Grayson's personal story.
Oh, yeah.
And she comes to just kind of shake up his world a little bit. Not as much as when later.
No. But, no, she basically says, like, you're still on for being the protector of the world.
Yeah.
We're going to be back. Make sure you're with us or against us.
Uh-huh.
He's against. And she beats the snot out of him again.
Yep. It comes out that Nolan misses his wife.
Mm-hmm.
So that relationship can maybe rekindle there.
Alan the alien lets himself get captured by
mm-hmm.
the Viltrumites.
Yep.
So he can initiate a jailbreak
right.
with Nolan.
Yep. And D.A. Sinclair gets hired by the U.S. government, and you find out now he's got a whole race of, like, super soldiers branded with a U.S. flag on.
Yep. Yeah.
And
that's where we
leave off.
Whew. Wow.
A lot going on here.
And Mark's younger brother is growing up and maturing
very
quickly.
That's what he gets from his alien mother.
Yeah, he's got his powers already,
mm-hmm.
and he helps Mark defeat a couple villains.
So much happened
it's
in
so
the first
good.
Nine trades.
Oh my god.
As the
a lot
story,
of world building.
A lot of world building. And as the story pushes on, it does narrow its focus a little bit,
mm-hmm.
but like these first nine trades, or the first compendium, is amazing in what kind of world that Kirkman built in this whole little corner of the Image universe over here.
Yeah. It feels like it's been going on for 25 years.
It really does. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like as fleshed out as the Marvel universe. So that's it. I mean, if any of this, if you've watched this and you haven't read it, hopefully this kind of sounds like, hey, yeah, that would be good.
Right.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
And you haven't just sat here for 45 minutes
just,
or so. Yeah. Because it's a good book. It's
uh-huh.
fun. Hopefully, you've read it, because we spoiled a lot of this,
uh-huh.
but regardless, jump on now.
Mm-hmm.
We've got two more jam-packed episodes coming
mm-hmm.
of our Invincible Trilogy.
Yep.
Our summer spectacular at Imperius Rex here. So, Troy, any last thoughts?
Just read Invincible.
Yeah.
It's
your favorite superhero book?
It's probably my favorite superhero book.
I can't argue. It's probably the best superhero book.
Yes.
Like
yeah.
Like long-running
yeah.
title.
Yeah. So that's what we thought of the first third of the Invincible run by Kirkman, Walker, and Ottley. What did you think of Invincible? Have you read it yet? I've actually talked to quite a few people that haven't even read it.
Oh, you gotta
it's
read
too
this.
Bad. You gotta get on this shit.
I think Phil, our friend Phil, is reading it,
yep.
diving in right now.
Yeah. Enjoy. You're gonna
yes.
love it. If
yep.
you don't, you're dead to me, Phil. You hear me? You're dead to me.
You're done.
But then, that's all we got really to say. So let us know in the comments down below what you think of Invincible, what you're looking forward to in the next coming episodes.
That's right.
So until next time, I've been Short of the Max Extreme.
And I've been Ghost Hunter Dave.
And together we've been Imperius Rex, and we'll see you next time for part 2 of Invincible.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.